graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents The Emperor's Soul, written by Brandon Sanderson, narrated by Colleen Delany, performed by Kimberly Gilbert, Mort Shelby, Nora Achrati, Thomas Keegan, Chris Genebach, Jacob Yeh, Bradley Smith, Lise Bruneau, Henry Kramer, Scott McCormick, Nanette Savard, Terence Aselford, Ken Jackson, Michael John Casey, Michael Glenn, Dani Stoller, Eric Messner, and Nathanial Perry. Gautona ran his fingers across the thick canvas, inspecting one of the greatest works of art he had ever seen. Unfortunately, it was a lie.
The woman is a danger. What she does is an abomination.
The voice belonged to Gautona's fellow arbiters, the Empire's most important bureaucrats. Gautona tipped the canvas toward the hearth's orange-red light, squinting. In his old age, his eyes weren't what they once had been. He inspected the brushstrokes, feeling the layers of thick oils.
Such precision. Exactly like those in the original.
He would never have spotted the mistakes on his own. A blossom slightly out of position. A moon that was just a sliver too low in the sky. It had taken their experts days of detailed inspection to find the errors.
She is one of the best forgers alive. She has a reputation as wide as the Empire. We need to execute her as an example.
No. She is a valuable tool. This woman can save us. We must use her.
This from the leader of the Arbiters, Frava.
Why? Why would someone capable of this artistry, this majesty, turn to forgery? Why not create original paintings? Why not be a true artist? I must understand.
Yes, the woman is a thief, and she practices a horrid art, but I can control her. With her talents, we can fix this mess we have found ourselves in.
The look on the other faces spoke of worried objections. The woman they spoke of, Wan Shai Lu, was more than a simple con artist. So much more. She could change the nature of reality itself. That raised another question.
Why would she bother learning to paint? Isn't ordinary art mundane compared to her mystical talents? So many questions.
Gautona looked up from his seat beside the hearth. The others stood in a conspiratorial clump around Frava's desk, their long, colorful robes shimmering in the firelight.
I agree with Frava.
The others glanced at him. Their scowls indicated they cared little for what he said, but their postures told a different tale. Their respect for him was buried deep, but it was remembered. Gautona rose.
Send for the forger. I would hear what she has to say. I suspect she will be more difficult to control than Frava claims, but we have no choice. We either use this woman's skill, or we give up control of the Empire. How many years has it been since Frava and I have agreed on anything at all, let alone on something so divisive as making use of the forger?
One by one, the other three arbiters nodded.
Let it be done.
Day 2. Shai pressed her fingernail into one of the stone blocks of her prison cell. The rock gave way slightly. She rubbed the dust between her fingers. Limestone. An odd material for use in a prison wall, but the whole wall wasn't of limestone. Merely that single vein within the block.
Limestone.
That little vein had been easy to miss, but if she was right about it, she had finally identified all 44 types of rock in the wall of her circular pit of a prison cell. She knelt down beside her bunk. Using a fork, She'd bent back all the tines but one to carve notes into the wood of one bed leg. Without her spectacles, she had to squint as she wrote. To forge something, you had to know its past, its nature. She was almost ready. Her pleasure quickly slipped away, however, as she noticed another set of markings on the bed leg, lit by her flickering candle. Those kept track of her days of imprisonment.
So little time.
If her count was right, only a day remained before the date set for her public execution. Deep inside, her nerves were drawn as tight as strings on an instrument.
One day.
One day remaining to create a soul stamp and escape. But she had no soul stone, only a crude piece of wood, and her only tool for carving was a fork. It would be incredibly difficult. That was the point. This cell was meant for one of her kind, built of stones with many different veins of rock in them to make them difficult to forge. They would come from different quarries and would each have a unique history. Knowing as little as she did, forging them would be nearly impossible. And even if she did transform the rock, there was probably some other failsafe to stop her.
Knights, what a mess I've gotten myself into.
Notes finished, she found herself looking at her bent fork. She'd begun carving the wooden handle after prying off the metal portion as a crude soul stamp.
You're not going to get out this way, Shai. You need another method.
She'd waited 6 days, searching for another way out. Guards to exploit, someone to bribe, a hint about the nature of her cell. So far, nothing. Far above, the door to the dungeons opened. Shai leapt to her feet, tucking the fork handle into her waistband at the small of her back.
Did they move up my execution?
She squinted at the newcomers who appeared above her cell. Four were guards, accompanying a man with long features and fingers. A Grand, the race who led the Empire. That robe of blue and green indicated a minor functionary who had passed the tests for government service, but not risen high in its ranks. The Grand leaned down to look at her through the grate.
Open it.
Shai stood back as they opened her cell ceiling, then lowered a ladder.
The arbiters wish to interrogate you, Forger.
She climbed, wary. If she were going to take someone to an early execution, she'd have let the prisoner think something else was happening so she wouldn't resist. However, they didn't lock Shai in manacles as they marched her out of the dungeons. Judging by their route, they did indeed seem to be taking her toward the arbiter's study. Shai walked in front.
A new challenge, then.
Dare she hope for an opportunity? She shouldn't have been caught, but she could do nothing about that now. She had been bested, betrayed by the Imperial fool when she'd assumed she could trust him. He had taken her copy of the Moon Scepter and swapped it for the original, then run off. Shai's uncle Juan had taught her that being bested was a rule of life. No matter how good you were, someone was better. Live by that knowledge, and you would never grow so confident that you became sloppy. Last time, she had lost.
This time, I will win. This time, I'm playing not for riches, but my life.
The guards were strikers, or, well, that was the Grand name for them. They had once called themselves Maladil, but their nation had been folded into the Empire so long ago that few used the name. Strikers were a tall people, with a lean musculature and pale skin. They had hair almost as dark as Shai's, though theirs curled while hers lay straight and long. She tried with some success not to feel dwarfed by them. Her people, the Maipan, were not known for their stature.
You. I remember you.
Judging by that styled hair, the youthful captain did not often wear a helmet. Strikers were well regarded by the Grands, and their elevation was not unheard of. This one had a look of eagerness to him. That polished armor, that crisp air. Yes, he fancied himself bound for important things in the future.
The horse. You threw me over the back of your horse after I was captured. Tall animal. Gurish descent. Pure white. Good animal. You know your horse flesh.
The striker kept his eyes forward.
I'm going to enjoy killing you, woman.
Lovely.
They entered the imperial wing of the palace. The stonework here was marvelous, after the ancient Lamio style, with tall pillars of marble inlaid with reliefs. Those large urns between the pillars had been created to mimic Lamio pottery from long ago.
Actually, the Heritage faction still rules, so...
The Emperor would be from that faction, as would the Council of Five Arbiters who did much of the actual ruling. Their faction lauded the glory and learning of past cultures, even going so far as to rebuild their wing of the palace as an imitation of an ancient building. Shai suspected that on the bottoms of those ancient urns would be soul stamps that had transformed them into perfect imitations of famous pieces. Yes, the Grands called Shai's powers an abomination, but their only aspect that was technically illegal was creating a forgery to change a person. Quiet forgery of objects was allowed, even exploited in the Empire, so long as the forger was carefully controlled. If someone were to turn over one of those urns and remove the stamp on the bottom, the piece would become simple, unornamented pottery. The strikers led her to a door with gold inlay. She managed to catch a glimpse of the red soul stamp on the bottom inside edge, transforming the door into an imitation of some work from the past. The guards ushered her into a homey room with a crackling hearth, deep rugs, and stained wood furnishings.
5th century hunting lodge?
All five arbiters of the Heritage faction waited inside. Three, two women, one man, sat in tall-backed chairs at the hearth. One other woman occupied the desk just inside the doors. Frava, senior among the arbiters of the Heritage faction, was probably the most powerful person in the Empire other than Emperor Ashravan himself. Her graying hair was woven into a long braid with gold and red ribbons. It draped a robe of matching gold. Shai had long pondered how to rob this woman as, among her duties, Frava oversaw the Imperial Gallery and had offices adjacent to it. Frava had obviously been arguing with Gautona, the elderly male grand standing beside the desk. He stood up straight and clasped his hands behind his back in a thoughtful pose. Gautona was eldest of the ruling arbiters. He was said to be the least influential among them, out of favor with the Emperor. Both eyed her as if she were a cat that had just knocked over a fine vase. Shai missed her spectacles, but took care not to squint as she stepped up to face these people. She needed to look as strong as possible. Frava picked up a sheet of paper from the desk.
Wan Shai Lu, you have quite the list of crimes credited to your name. Impersonating a noblewoman of rank, breaking into the palace's imperial gallery, reforging your soul, and, of course, the attempted theft of the Moon Scepter. Did you really assume that we would fail to recognize a simple forgery of such an important imperial possession?
You have done just that, assuming that the fool escaped with the original.
It gave Shai a little thrill of satisfaction to know that her forgery now occupied the Moon Scepter's position of honor in the imperial gallery.
And what of this?
A striker produced a painting and placed it on the desk. Han Shushen's masterpiece, Lily of the Spring Pond.
We found this in your room at the inn. It is a copy of a painting I myself own, one of the most famous in the Empire. We gave it to our assessors, and they judged that your forgery was amateur at best.
Shai met the woman's eyes. Frava leaned forward.
Tell me why you have created this forgery. You were obviously planning to swap this for the painting in my office by the Imperial Gallery, and yet you were striving for the Moon Scepter itself. Why plan to steal the painting, too? Greed?
My Uncle Juan told me to always have a backup plan. I couldn't be certain the scepter would even be on display.
Ah. You requested arbiter intervention in your execution, as most prisoners do. I decided on a whim to agree to your request because I was curious why you had created this painting. But child, you can't honestly believe we'd let you free. With sins like this, you are in a monumentally bad predicament, and our mercy can only be extended so far.
She glanced toward the other arbiters. The ones seated near the fireplace seemed to be paying no heed, but they did not speak to one another. They were listening.
Something is wrong. They're worried.
An opportunity.
It is time to take control of this conversation. You want something from me? I'm ready to discuss my payment.
Your payment? Girl, you are to be executed on the morrow. If we did wish something of you, the payment would be your life.
My life is my own, and it has been for days now.
Please, you were locked in the forger's cell with 30 different kinds of stone in the wall.
44 kinds, actually.
Galtona raised an appreciative eyebrow.
You thought I wouldn't recognize the grindstone, didn't you? Please, I'm a forger. I learned stone classification during my first year of training. That block was obviously from the Lyo quarry.
Frava opened her mouth to speak, a slight smile to her lips.
Yes, I know about the plates of Rockalist, the unforgeable metal, hidden behind the rock wall of my cell. The wall was a puzzle, meant to distract me. He wouldn't actually make a cell out of rocks like limestone, just in case a prisoner gave up on forgery and tried to chip their way free. You built the wall, but secured it with a plate of Rauchalist at the back to cut off escape. The problem with Rauchalist is that it's not a very strong metal. Oh, the grate at the top of my cell was solid enough, and I couldn't have gotten through that. But a thin plate? Really? Have you heard of anthracite?
Frava snapped her mouth shut and frowned.
It is a rock that burns.
You gave me a candle.
Shai reached into the small of her back. She tossed her makeshift wooden soul stamp onto the desk.
All I had to do was forge the wall and persuade the stones that they're anthracite. Not a difficult task. Once I knew the 44 types of rock, I could burn them, and they'd melt that plate behind the wall.
Shai pulled over a chair, seating herself before the desk. She leaned back. Frava drew her lips to a line and said nothing. Shai let her muscles relax, and she breathed a quiet prayer to the unknown god.
Knights! They actually bought it!
She'd worried they'd know enough of forgery to see through her lie.
I was going to escape tonight, but whatever it is you want me to do must be important, as you're willing to involve a miscreant like myself. And so we come to my payment.
I could still have you executed. Right now. Here.
But you won't, will you?
I warned you that she would be difficult to manipulate.
Shai could tell she'd impressed him, but at the same time, his eyes seemed...
sorrowful? Is that the right emotion?
She found this aged man as difficult to read as a book in Svordish. Frava raised a finger, then swiped it to the side. A servant approached with a small cloth-wrapped box. Shai's heart leaped upon seeing it. The man opened the latches on the front and raised the top. The case was lined with soft cloth and inset with 5 depressions made to hold soul stamps. Each cylindrical stone stamp was as long as a finger and as wide as a large man's thumb. The leather-bound notebook set in the case atop them was worn by long use. Shai breathed in a hint of its familiar scent. They were called essence marks, the most powerful kind of soul stamp. Each essence mark had to be attuned to a specific individual and was intended to rewrite their history, personality, and soul for a short time. These 5 were attuned to Shai.
5 stamps to rewrite a soul. Each is an abomination, illegal to possess. These essence marks were to be destroyed this afternoon. Even if you had escaped, you'd have lost these. How long does it take to create one?
Years.
There were no other copies. Notes and diagrams were too dangerous to leave, even in secret, as such things gave others too much insight to one's soul. She'd never let these essence marks out of her sight, except on the rare occasion they were taken from her.
You will accept these as payment?
Yes.
Then let me show you what you are to do.
Shai had never met an emperor before, let alone poked one in the face. Emperor Ashravan of the 80 Suns, 49th ruler of the Rose Empire, did not respond as Shai prodded him. He stared blankly, his round cheeks rosy and hale, but his expression completely lifeless.
What happened?
Shai straightened from beside the emperor's bed. It was in the style of the ancient Lamio people, with a headboard shaped like a phoenix rising toward heaven. She'd seen a sketch of such a headboard in a book. Likely, the forgery had been drawn from that source.
Assassins.
Gautona stood on the other side of the bed, alongside two surgeons. Of the strikers, only their captain, Zhu, had been allowed to enter.
The murderers broke in two nights ago, attacking the Emperor and his wife. She was slain. The Emperor received a crossbow bolt to the head.
That considered, he's looking remarkable.
You are familiar with resealing?
Vaguely.
Her people called it flesh forgery. Using it, a surgeon of great skill could forge a body to remove its wounds and scars. It required great specialization. The forger had to know each and every sinew, each vein and muscle in order to accurately heal. Resealing was one of the few branches of forgery that Shai hadn't studied in depth. Get an ordinary forgery wrong and you created a work of poor artistic merit.
Get a flesh forgery wrong and people die.
Frava walked around the foot of the bed, hands behind her back.
Our resealers are the best in the world. The Emperor was attended to quickly following the assassination attempt. The wound to his head was healed, but...
But his mind was not? It doesn't sound like they did a very good job at all.
The surgeon who had cleared his throat was a diminutive man and had ears like window shutters that had been thrown open wide on a sunny day.
Resealing repairs a body and makes it anew. That, however, is much like rebinding a book with fresh paper following a fire. Yes, it may look exactly the same, and it may be whole all the way through. The words are gone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.